is going on?
There was a technology that was better than green screen.
This movie came out 15 years ago.
Those jets look so nice and shiny.
These are bad visual effects.
Yeah, those are straight up bad.
And you should feel bad about them.
I'm so confused.
Thanks to LG TV for sponsoring this video. All the clips we're watching today are being viewed on an LG NanoCell TV, so stick around to the end to learn about what makes this TV special.
Hey, welcome back to another episode of Visual Effects Artists React. We've had a bunch of stunt friends in here for the past couple weeks.
Hey, no more stuntman. We want the computer man back. Yeah, that's right. That's what I was saying too the last few weeks. But we're back with some Visual Effects Artists React.
Today, we got some pretty fascinating stuff. One in particular is pretty nuts because did you guys know that there was a technology that was arguably better than green screen that was invented back in 1950? So if you want to see how that works and more, stay tuned. All right, let's jump in.
Commence. Oh, yes. Oh, Jesus Christ.
All right, so Stephen King wrote a series of short stories. The Langoliers was one of them. The premise is this. They're flying an airplane and it flies through a rip in space.
What?
They proceed to land at an airport in the alternate reality because they've accidentally traveled to a parallel dimension.
The Langoliers are coming.
So there's this parallel dimensional alien race called the Langoliers whose job it is to dispose of these old dimensions. And they must get back to theirs before they get consumed.
No! No! Wait, the Langoliers are the meatballs?
Yes.
Dude, Mama, frickin' Mia. Oh my God.
Daddy, no! Make them go away! Please make them go away!
Oh no, don't eat me! This movie's 3 hours long! I can't act for this long!
Whoa, that was cool. Okay, I don't care what either of you say, them crunching through the ground like that, I liked that. That was sweet. It leaves behind like where the two pieces were together. Like there's actual some good detail there.
All I have to say about the meatballs is this. There's some very, very basic things they could have done to make them look better.
In the year 1995?
In the year 1995.
Well, like what?
Making sure that the image quality of your CG isn't like light years ahead of the image quality of your video. They probably shot this in like 16 millimeter film. You know, it's not the highest res, it's not super crisp per se. And you can really see like the issue there with like how crisp the CG is and how dark the shadows are.
I think two things. First off, horrible animation. I see keyframes, I don't see like physics, so to speak. That's the first huge problem. The second one is we have a scene with a bunch of interdimensional monsters. Like, where is the scariest place to shoot that? What's the scariest setting? And let's do bright, overcast daylight on a completely beige environment. And it's like, well, you're screwed. There's nothing to obscure the creatures in the environment. The lighting doesn't play towards the poor rendering. It's poor filmmaking going into it.
What would have made this better is generally the people shooting the effects, understanding the process of their shooting shots that can help the effects, you know?
Yeah, but how many people really even understood any of this 25 years ago? This came out just a couple years after Jurassic Park. Like, the number of people who probably knew how to do this better are very small, and they probably just weren't able to afford them for this piece. Because they probably had a tiny budget to begin with.
I'm just saying, cut an hour off the movie and use the thousands and thousands of dollars it would have taken to film that extra hour.
This is back in the day when it was only TV, and at a certain point you just need to fill time.
I think that's really what this was.
Yeah.
They were just filling time. They're like, what of our thousands of Stephen King properties is worth making today?
So I was recently reminded about a movie called Stealth by this website called beforesandafters.com. If you want to dive more into how visual effects and stuff like that work, that's a fantastic resource and website to check out. So the movie Stealth basically is around these three super pro fighter pilots. They have these really cool like Navy stealth jets that are really fast, and then they have to contend with an AI who's gonna tick their gerbs. The movie itself isn't very good, but the effects are top class from Digital Domain. They're very excellently done. They pioneered a whole bunch of stuff for this movie, and it really shows.
This looks great. This is right when like physically based rendering is starting to become a thing. It's like not even quite there yet. It's like they're just artists at the top of the game understanding light.
Yeah, this movie came out 15 years ago.
Those jets look so nice and shiny.
And all of this is completely computer generated. There are no photographic plates here. The background is all computer generated.
Back then, like, it was very, very, very hard to do clouds.
What do you do for clouds? It's like, usually you're sitting there like, all right, I'll take a 2D image, make a background. It's like, well, I gotta move through them. It's like, well, are we just gonna put a bunch of cards in the scene, like little 2D sprites?
This was a very unique problem for the VFX team here because there were tons of clouds rendered everywhere for them to go through. They ended up having to generate, we're talking dozens and dozens of square miles worth of just clouds. And that meant a lot and lot of data. We're talking hundreds of gigabytes worth of data. And they had to come up with a special workflow just to process all of the clouds. We're talking like low resolution clouds off in the distant background, and then medium range clouds that they're actually flying through. Those were the high res ones. And that combined with, you know, the really high resolution planes flying through them and the camera flying through at really high speeds. All of that to just give a sense of speed going through everything. But the thing that was surprising to me is the fact that the cockpits are glass. The helmet visors are glass. And how do you film glass without having the reflections of the crew, of the camera, appear in the shot? And the answer is you just do it digitally. And so there's a moment when Django Unchained here, he actually like knocks on his helmet, but he's just miming it. It's just kind of like, and you can kind of see his floaty hand, but they add a sound effect of a.
Now that's how you do it.
I want to do a quick shout out. Talking about stealth, to the best explosion ever committed to film. Hell yeah.
Okay, that is pretty sweet.
So
those people were
good.
Actually there. And those trucks were actually like flipping.
Oh my amazing. God. Yeah, Christian just muttered Jesus under his breath back there. So amazing. And like the fake cars, if you look closely, you can see it's just like canvas over pipe frames. This is magic. This is something special right here. Baby, it's
So stealth was actually recommended to me in a comment, and you're totally right, we had to talk about it. Thank you for that comment. If you have other clips that you think we should watch, leave a comment down below.
What's happening to me?
Wait, is this the old Twin Peaks or the new Twin Peaks?
No, it's the old. As we can see, it's the elderly Twin Peaks.
Oh!
Is he getting tiny hands?
Wait! He's shrinking!
Whoa.
Whoa, wait, what? Just a jump cut to his head turning into black smoke?
Okay.
Is he a snitch? Did he turn into the snitch?
What?
Ooh, ooh, that tracking, what, or whatever was going on there.
What the f-
What? That was a 2D stretch
this is
photo!
A visual effect?
What is going on here? Oh, and now it's a physical what? I'm so confused.
This feels like very authentic to like the visual effects of the time when this series originally came out. Do you feel like those visual effects were good or bad? The thing is, I would make an argument here that David Lynch didn't want any realism whatsoever. He just wanted the collage-y, basic cutout element feeling style of the effects. It was just imagery. It just cuts to it. It just moves. It just does its thing.
No, these are bad visual effects.
Yeah, those are straight up bad.
And you should feel bad about them.
The hand shrinking, I don't know how they did that. It kind of looked like it was a practical thing. It kind of looked like they were shrinking it, but then the ring fell off. See, that looks very good, and I have no idea what's going on there. But then his head literally just pops away, and then this like golden orb is just moving around with no motion blur and really hard, sharp keyframes.
And the highlight is just as bright on it when it's in the smoke versus when it's out.
Yeah. And then this thing is literally just the final image here, but it's stretched vertically. So you're having like all these stretched pixels, and then it pops to a different element as it starts to evolve and move. I have no idea what's going on!
What is going on?
Every time I think it's done being ridiculous, it gets more ridiculous and confusing. And maybe that's the point.
Did David Lynch actually do this shot?
I would not be surprised if David Lynch did those effects himself.
It's more abstract and subjective, I guess, but now I feel like I'm just making excuses.
Yeah. I mean, we all kind of are.
This is like an art gallery, by the way, where everyone's right. Every one of these opinions is 100% correct.
I'm all down for like weird, janky, crazy visual stuff. But like, you know, as my art teacher said when I submitted a half-assed drawing, if you're intentionally trying to do something that doesn't look good, you need to make sure it's really intentional so it doesn't feel like a mistake.
I mean, if it's like, if the goal is to go, hey, look at this weird thing, and you're like, this is weird, it's weird. He did it. He got us. What's up, guys? Today's opposite day. Hit unsubscribe, dislike the video, flag others' comments. I know what you're not doing right now.
Wait a second. This movie was made before computers. These aren't visual effects. Visual effects are designed with PCs.
That's not true. The visual and visual effects means that you're using optical printers.
Sorry, I'm distracted by the fact that this dude has, like, pants with the crotch down at his ankles.
Dude's way out of his time for joggers, man.
Is the background a cartoon as well? Was it painted on a wall? It looks like it might be a mural and they're on a little soundstage.
That background was not there when they filmed.
Okay.
In Star Wars, you can tell when they're on a fake background. But this is from 1964, and you can't tell that background wasn't there in the film. Take a look at Mary Poppins' hat. What's special about that hat?
It's transparent!
It's transparent!
It's transparent!
If somebody hires me to do VFX supervision, and they're like, all right, we're gonna have this person from a green screen, they're gonna have all this transparent, like, lace, I'd be like, no, don't do it. This is in 1964. How do you get transparency without a computer?
All right, so, like, okay, Star Wars, you make black and white mats on a piece of film, and then you use the white layer to basically expose the light onto the part of the image that you want to keep.
We talked a lot about this in our episode talking about the original Star Wars movies because they did all of these effects using just optical separation of light and stuff like that. If you want to find out more information, check out that episode.
So in Star Wars, they filmed their ships on a blue screen.
But the thing about that, Nico, is that you're getting a very distinct black or white matte for there. There's no transparency in between.
Yes, 100%. Also, nobody can wear blue. In this scene, he has a blue tie. He has blue socks and the ground is green. What color could they use? Every color is in this frame.
That MF-er is sprinkling salt. He's sprinkling salt.
They're using sodium vapor lights. And sodium vapor lights emit light specifically on only one part of the electromagnetic spectrum. So it's a very strict slice of
light. That's right. Yep. Okay. Yes.
It's basically just a sodium vapor wash on the background. And they have a Technicolor camera. So back in the day, Technicolor cameras ran three strips of film. One strip of black and white film for red, one strip of black and white film for green, and one strip of black and white film for blue. And you can combine that and get colors. And they took one of those cameras, and they modified it to only have two strips, and they have a prism. And the prism splits off the wavelength of sodium vapor light to one film roll, and then everything else, all the rest of the light goes to another film roll. So in the moment when they're rolling the shot, there's two pieces of film, one that's getting the shot and one that's getting a perfect black and white mask with transparency of the background because it's only exposing to a certain wavelength. So it's the perfect split because the light is so physically being split and like selected.
That's so complicated.
It is.
It's basically a perfect map before you even post-process it.
It seems too good to be true. Why are we not still using this technology today?
Yeah, really, what gives?
So the reason is they basically invented this one-off magical device. Like, it's the closest thing you could get to magic because they were never able to replicate the prism.
What? Wait, what? So you're saying the camera, the prism, the little heart of the camera is a one-of-a-kind piece
of glass. Dude, it's like a lightsaber. They have a one-of-a-kind crystal gem in the middle of this camera.
What do you mean one? You just can't... There's no such thing as just making one of something. How can we not recreate this? We're definitely dealing with off-world technology. Look, if anyone knows where that crystal of power is and has a map, basically our next episode will be tracking it down and shooting something with it.
All right, so after filming this episode, there's one thing I've been thinking about this entire time looking at this TV, and that's the fact that if we play Smash Bros, my character is going to be about as big as me. So let's go get a game in real quick because I've been itching to do that.
Here, let me get first place real quick.
So big thanks to LG for sponsoring this episode. This is the new LG NanoCell. This is an 86-inch television. It is a work of art. So I'm gonna tell you all about what makes this TV special while I kick all their butts. Now, this TV offers something called Pure Color Technology, which uses LG's NanoCell filters to give you the most vibrant color possible. Also, another great thing about this TV is they offer 4K up to 86 inches and 8K up to 75 inches. That's right, you can get your own 8K television. On top of that, they have a bunch of great gaming modes, which we make use of all the time here in the office. There's a low latency, 1 millisecond of lag only mode for the TV, which is awesome. It's everything I could ever want in a TV. Plus they have FreeSync, variable refresh rate, all that good stuff. And of course, a giant size that your Smash character is at least as big as an action figure. So excuse me for a second here while I win this game. So as you can see, LG delivers superior gaming technology and an immersive experience. Click the link in the description below and click the Where to Buy button to see retail price. Once again, big thanks to LG for sponsoring this series. And you know what? I personally actually love these televisions. I own one myself. They're great. Check them out.
Did that just happen? Did that just happen? Well, it's always a good time sitting down with buddies and looking at some cool VFX. Next week, we have a sword master coming in to show us all the cool things about sword choreography on film. That's gonna be super cool, so tune in for that episode.